Hi all, good evening. A very good evening to each and everyone present here. It gives me great pleasure to introduce to you all today's esteemed guest, Mr. Pavan Sathyaraju. Mr. Pavan is a serial entrepreneur and specialized in management consulting, problem solving, and interview preparation. Post his stint at McKinsey, he has co-founded various ventures like AlterHop, Global College Info, and Cases Over Coffee. He is also an INSEAD and NIT alumnus. Thank you so much for gracing us with your presence today, sir. On behalf of XLRI's XPGDM batch, we would like to extend our heartiest welcome to you. We are all eagerly looking forward towards the session. And on that note, over to you, sir.
Hey, thank you so much, guys. First of all, no formalities, no sir, please. Okay, all of us, let's make sure that the next 1 hour is productive and you take out at least a few things walking out of the session, okay? And one mic check, can you guys hear me okay?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay,
yes,
awesome.
Sir.
Yeah,
yes, let's sir.
If there is any kind of disturbance with respect to my internet, please let me know. I'll try to change the source. But guys, I'll pull out a presentation get started with the presentation in a minute. But just want to understand that, hey, you guys come in with a lot of experience yourselves, right? Hey, you are doing the exec MBA. You have been in the workforce quite a bit. Now, can I understand a bit very quickly about what is the rationale why you guys are in this specific conversation, right? Why does consulting interest you, or why do you want to actually sit in this session for 1 hour rather than watching a Netflix show, right? Or you can honestly tell me that, hey, this is a mandatory session. Okay, that works too. But just want to know why.
So we all know that consulting in an interview, consulting is going to be playing a huge role. And we figured that, you know, who better than someone who has greater experience than you. So we just wanted to gather as much as
possible. Would love to hear a few more answers.
So all the problems, be it in any organization, they're all based on case studies. So every problem can be categorized in the form of a case study problem. And then how to approach and how to solve the problem will determine the success of solving the problem. So that is why this case study approach is very important.
Okay. Fair enough.
So we have been reading of... Sorry, go ahead.
Hi, Pawan. Prabhakar this side. So first of all, we are not forced into this meeting.
Okay.
And we are here doing this exact MBA because we all want a leap in our careers. Regarding why particularly this session, so as Divya rightly said that the cases are used in consulting company as well as most of the B school, be it international B school, be it Indian B school like IIM Ahmedabad and others, all are following this pedagogy, right? So cases become very important for us to excel in our careers because we would be joining in mid-management role. And cases, in short, gives us real life business problems and how various managers or how people have, you know, approached to solve those problems.
Fair.
So that's the best way of for an MBA student to, you know, because we will be facing these problems.
So Prabhakar and Divya, so both of you have mentioned similar things, but let me just clear one thing, guys. So you guys have been using case studies, the word case studies quite a bit, but let me clear up, okay? Probably a few guys might drop out of immediately as well what I say, but case studies is different from basically case solving from an interview perspective, okay? Or basically solving a case in a business perspective. All these three are different. Case studies that you do, right? What you guys mentioned with your Prabhakar, what you guys mentioned is about learning a concept, right? Hey, whether it's IIM Ahmedabad, INSEAD, doesn't matter whichever school it is, you basically have a 10-page study to understand a financial accounting concept, right? To understand about statistics or to understand about, hey, that most feared, null hypothesis, all these kind of concepts, right? So that is basically steady approach to learn about a particular concept, right? You still have a business situation But the objective of that case study is to understand the concept. But now what we'll talk through for the next 1 hour, the context is that, hey, there is a business problem specifically, and the objective of the business problem is to basically crack the interview for you, right? Literally speaking. Or in other way, hey, is there a solution to that business problem? You don't need to know financial accounting. You don't need to know null hypothesis. You don't need to know anything, right? If anybody fears, let's say, statistics, which we all do to an extent, you don't need to worry about case studies, because hey, this session is more about case interviews as such, okay? And there is a slight difference. I hope you get it, right? Now, one quick reason why, if I may say so, that hey, what are some of the questions that I solved as a consultant, okay? I'll tell you my quick background is, I was an ex-consultant, ex-engagement manager in McKinsey San Francisco office. And whether it is San Francisco, whether it is Mumbai, Jakarta, doesn't matter. You are basically solving a client problem, right? Like we all did in our jobs previously. Now the problem is very strategic in nature. And the question could be like, hey, the sales of one of the Fortune 10 software companies in the world, the sales of their hardware or software B2B customer is like the profitability, or their sales are declining for the last 2 years. Now, what should they do to basically get to the right answer? Okay, so that's the kind of a question that you solve as a consultant. Okay, that's the business case. Now, let's not talk about the case studies that you do in your classrooms. Let's talk about these two, the examination or the interview case and the case that you actually do as a consultant. The case that you do as a consultant, the good part is that nobody knows the answer, right? The client doesn't know the answer. You don't know the answer on day one. Nobody knows the answer, right? So you problem solve continuously. You think through and you want to come up with a logical answer, which you can back up. Okay. One quick caveat, if anybody is interested in consulting as such, consulting is not the place where you will continuously think about out of the box ideas. Okay. Because consultants work a lot on data driven, or let's say if you are talking about something, you want to make sure that you are not pulling out of your thin hat. Okay. You are coming up with a valid logic and rationale for that particular suggestion. Okay. So it is not so much for creative people, I would say, but probably you would not enjoy that field. But it is basically a field for folks who are interested in enjoy solving business problems, right? And these business problems definitely don't have an answer, and that's the good thing, right? Now, the difference between the interview case, right, is that the interviewer, if imagine that, hey, I'm taking an interview for Abhishek Patel, hey, Abhishek, come into the interview room, what should this software company do now to go back into the V-shaped recovery or cut down its declining profitabilities and ensure on the road of success, right? What should it do? You might think that, hey, this is a broad answer. I already have an answer. Let me speak out from my mind. But that's not the case. The interviewer will have an answer, right? So that's the difference. The interviewer will have an answer. And for example, if I share that, hey, if this is what I'm writing notes on continuously, basically I know that, hey, this is the first point. I can evaluate Abhishek Patak on this metric, then this metric, then this metric, right? Remove Pawan Sathiraju and put any other person into the mix, the interview outcomes would almost remain the same, because these guys, the interviewers, are also evaluating somebody through an objective measure. It's not subjective that, hey, this guy is good versus not. It's an objective measure, and the interviewer also has a responsibility to their HRs, right? And tell their HR that, hey, why Abhishek Patak is good or not. And again, all these discussions, just like how the client conversations happen, these are data-driven decisions. You need to support very, very clearly that, hey, why you are inviting somebody into the second round, third round, or giving a final offer, or telling that, hey, why you are not giving a final offer. Both should be extremely clear. So that level of clarity can't come if you don't know the answer, right? So that's the difference. So the first case study in a classroom is to learn a concept. The case study or the case in a real world consulting is where nobody knows the answer. And in between, when you are solving for an interview, the interviewer knows the answer, right? Now let's jump into, and let me pick up the presentation. Okay, just give me 1 second. I'll pick up the presentation and let's walk through it. As you can imagine, a consultant or an ex-consultant never gets into a conversation without a PowerPoint, right? So I'll do the same thing. Just give me 1 second. Okay, all right. So let's keep moving. So we'll talk through a bit about why cases are needed to start with. Okay. What are the skills that are tested? As I mentioned that, hey, you have a evaluation sheet, right? So why and what are being measured, right? What is considered good versus what is considered excellent, right? I would imagine that, hey, all the 104 of you guys who are on the call, all of you are good, no questions about that. But what makes you different and what can help you cross that cut and, let's say, get an offer in the consulting firm or any gold standard firm for that matter? What are the things that you need to keep adding to your profile, right? Or what are the things that you need to keep mentioning in your interview? Let's talk about a bit of those. There is a difference between being good and being excellent in the interviews. Okay, that's number two. And number three, of course, we'll solve a live case. Okay, we'll start probably with solving a few case studies as well. Now, we talked about the cases, and let me tell you why this is important. Why solving case, at least from an interview standpoint, is important. The first and third points, let's not discuss about it right now. Okay, the case interview questions more and more are not only asked by consulting firms, right? These are asked by companies like Amazon, companies like Microsoft, or even investment banking firms or any other financial services firms as well, right? So the spectrum of companies which are using case solving or case problem statements to evaluate a candidate are increasing. More and more companies from the gold standard tier, so to say the best companies out there, are employing this method, right? Why? Let us talk through that. So imagine you guys are owners of a retail store, okay? Or you own multiple retail stores at several airports. The revenues are going down for one of your key stores, not every store, but only one of your key stores. Now, how will you go about identifying and solving the problem? Before you guys pick up the mic and start answering the question, I would request all of you guys to take at least a minute or two to think about the problem. Don't come up with an answer straight away. Think for a minute or two. Question statement: you own multiple retail stores at several airports. The revenues are going down for one of your key stores. How will you go about identifying and solving the problem? Okay. All right, guys. Please start sharing your thoughts.
Good evening, sir.
Go ahead.
I'm Arya. Sir, so probably the first step to identifying the problem would be to figure out whether the issue is something that is an intrinsic problem. For example, if we have changed the price points in a certain way, which may have affected this, number one. Number second would be whether the footfall has been, you know, if there's an external problem such as footfall, maybe the number of flights that have been operating have had slight fluctuations. So these are things that are not directly in our control, but these could be the two things okay. that we could broadly put it into.
Okay.
Hello, sir.
Go ahead, Aditya.
Yeah. So just wanted to say that first identify the reason for decline, I would say.
Okay.
Is it an internal or an external reason? For example, if there's a travel ban at a particular place or what, it could be one of those reasons, something like that, or maybe something like what happened in Wuhan, the first round of pandemic. So nobody wanted to travel to Wuhan. So that could be one of the reasons. So find out the reason first and then maybe we can get a better idea.
Okay. All right.
Yes, sir. So
can I look at the whether there is any new competitor in that particular airport?
Okay.
First, you have to find out, is this an airport-based problem? I mean, location-based problem, rather, I should say.
Hi, sir. Utkarsh.
Hi, sir.
Sir, adding to the competitors part, there's one more point. Once, like Aditya said, once we have found out the reason that would be for the decline, whether the travel ban or the pandemic, we can also consider that if the staff that we have deployed in the store currently is a skilled staff or not, or are we understaffed? Are we going understaffed for a heavy crowd? And the stock that is being supplied there, is the stock getting updated? The item stock, is that getting updated or not? I mean, are we still keeping the old things in the retail store?
Okay.
So that is one thing.
Hi, sir.
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
So, sir, there can be problems related to location that my colleagues have mentioned. Staff problem, management problem, and it can be the quality problem also at a particular store. And the solution can be we can swap the management or the staff which are working fine, and we can identify what is exactly the problem.
Okay, all right. So,
sir,
just hold on for a second. Okay. Now let me do this. Okay. We have written a few answers. Now you tell me the answers that how many points do you remember? Do you remember all the points that are written out there on the whiteboard?
I guess there was some, Utkarsh, I guess there's some, flawed answer, some answer which were not correct, because it was said that only one shop is actually having problem, not all of them. So that means that there is some sort of a difference of one shop as compared to the other.
Hold on. So you should answer my question. Do you remember all the points that are written on the whiteboard or no?
No.
We don't know.
Not all of them.
No, not all of them, right? So right. Now you might have 100 different ideas, and are you sure that you are going on thinking about more and more and more ideas? And do you think that the interviewer will remember what you are saying?
No, sir.
Probably.
Really unlikely. No, sir. I don't question, or I don't even want to get into the debate of whether a single point is correct or not. You yourself can say that, hey, probably some of the guys have talked about location, some of them have talked about price points, but you just can't say that, hey, answer one was about this, answer two was about this, answer three was about this. You just can't do it. Right. The reason is that, hey, the answer doesn't have a structure. So that's the first thing. As a consultant, the most important thing that when you go and talk to a client, it is not about the issues that, hey, why a software company's profitability is going down. That's secondary. But the first thing for you is that, hey, whatever you are saying, the other person should remember. Whether you want to tell it through a beautiful story or whether you want to tell it in a highly bulleted format, that's completely up to you. That's a very personal thing, right? But you need to make sure that the other person remembers, right? Now, what works typically in the consulting space, right? Or in an interview, these guys expect a structure. So the first thing that anybody is thinking about is the structure. Now, what does it mean to develop a structure? What does structure look like? Right? So let's say answer two or answer one, right? If again, to this particular interview question, right now, nobody knows the answer. The answer could be anything, right? So if you take a long, let's say there are 10 factors, okay? Price could be one factor, location could be another factor, competitors could be another, inventory, staff, so on, so on, so forth, correct? There could be 10 different factors. Now, when you talked about, let's say the first person answer one, it was a lot getting deeper into the price points. They were saying that, hey, the price points could be changing, the footfalls could be dropping because of ABC reasons, right? So on, so forth. But your job is to make sure that, hey, you cover the entire spectrum right at the front so that the chances of you hitting the right answer are the most. If you keep talking about price, if you keep talking about footfalls, you are not going to ever talk about competitors or location, right? So your objective in the given 2 minutes is not to go deep. Your objective in the given 2 minutes is to go broad. Then you say that, hey, Pavan, I think there could be 5 different reasons, right? The 5 different reasons could be competitors, right? It could be the staff, right? Or it could be the merchandising, or it could be location. Okay, 4 different areas. Something which you can't control, the location, something which you can control, inventory and staff, right? And the 4th one, probably competition, right? Now, 2 things that you can control and 2 things that you can't control. That is how I'm making sure that I'm drilling the point in you guys, right? Hey, again, you would not remember if I say these are the 4 points, right? If I tell you that, hey, this is price, this is location, this is inventory, right? And if I close it out and I'll say, ask you again, majority of them can't remember all the 10 points, right? But I will help you remember it. I will say that, hey, Bhavya and Anand, basically the answer, you need to think about it in 2 ways. One, what you can control and what you can't control. What can you control? Probably the staff, the skill level of the staff and the merchandising, right? Now, what can't you control? Let's say competition and pandemic. That's it. I'll leave it there. The interviewer will remember and you will remember. I'm not bringing out any additional points. I'm only giving you a structure of how you can think about it. And the difference is that I'm, instead of giving you in terms of 4, people can't remember 4 things, but people can remember 2 things, right? Or 3. So I'm giving you 2 things and saying that, hey, you remember it in the way that, hey, what you can control and what you can't control. That is, hey, what are the factors internal to your company and what are the factors external to your company? That's it. That's the way you start. So any specific case interview question, the way you need to start it is basically think about not just one. The usual tendency, what happens is, hey, if the first point that strikes your mind is about price, you will tend to think about the next 1 minute about price itself. Hey, why did the price increase? Why did the price not increase? Competitors, if it's the competition point, you'll start thinking about various factors within competition. But that's not how the interviews are evaluated. Imagine that, hey, if the price is the issue and you bring up the price point, you are lucky. But if competition is the issue and you keep on talking about price, literally, you know what's going to happen, right? So you basically, to increase your chances, you need to think broad. And how can you think broad? Be across the spectrum. But the issue that if you think across the spectrum and keep saying things, the other person can't remember. And for the other person to remember, you need to group things. So just to take a step back, what the most important thing when you are giving out a structured answer in any case interview is the fact that, hey, what is the entire tree, right? The tree should have branches. The first branch of the tree that you guys should be thinking about is, hey, what are the internal factors and what are the external factors which could change the revenues of that particular store? Now, if this is internal and this is external, within internal, I need to think about again 2 things. Within external, I'm thinking about 2 things. Somebody gave the answer that internal or external, but hey, you did not speak anything about external. You only spoke about 2 things about internal and done, left the answer. But you need to think about internal and external. And also, now, you think about, you prepare for solving these kind of problems. Of course, in the next 1 week itself, you will start talking about, hey, these are internal issues, these are external issues, right? If I ask, why did the profitability of a store go down? You can't say every time internal and external, right? That's where the practice kicks in. You need to practice a lot of these kind of cases to understand that, hey, every single time you can't say internal, external, or revenues and costs. Or I'll use some kind of framework that I read in Victor Chang's book. You just cannot do that, because all the other 108 guys in the call will also do the exact same thing. Now, where does it differ? I am not saying that, hey, only one or two will be selected. Consulting companies are such that, hey, they select all the good guys. If all the 108 are good, they'll select all the 108, right? But your viewpoint could be different from the other person's viewpoint only if you think about the problem at hand. If you're borrowing some kind of framework from a certain book or some certain conversation that you remember, then you are not adding any ingenuity into the conversation, right? To add that originality and to make sure that your viewpoints come up, you need to think about the case specifically. Make sense? So just to remember the points that we talked about, right? These are pretty important points. I hope if you guys remember something from this session, this should be it. Nothing else, okay? If there is only one thing that you remember, this should be it, right? So always, always, if you are getting started with your entire case prep thing right now or in the last 1 month, to start with, it's extremely difficult for you to start dividing them into groups right from the start, okay? So this is what I would give you some kind of ideas on how to do it, okay? You can say that, hey, competitors. Now competitors are done, let me think about price. Now pricing is done, let me think about location. Let me talk about, hey, pandemic specific to the city, right? Then I will talk about merchandising problems. Then I will talk about my sales problems, right? I will first list down 10 things. And then you need to restrict yourself and say that, hey, the interviewer is not as intelligent as me, so I cannot say these 10 things. I need to tell only 3 things, but I know more. What do I do? Let me group them up. So rather than starting with the groupings, until you at least get comfortable, solve 5 to 10 cases, you go the other way around. And then you will switch the mode. Okay. You can say that, hey, these are external, right? This is an external factor. Then this is an external factor, or these are the things that the company can't control, right? Or if I think more about it, these are location specific, right? Competitors and location and this one. So these 3 could be location driven factors, right? These could be store problems, right? Pricing, I doubt if they have pricing policies different for every store. So probably I wouldn't mention this within this, probably I'll add it into a different bucket. So I'm talking about 3 buckets. One is specific to that location. Competitors could be there. The store location might not be good, or the pandemic. Then I'm talking about internal problems like merchandising and sales. Then the third problem, probably across the stores, the problem is visible only at one store, but probably next month you'll start declining, seeing the declines in other stores as well. That could be the reason for the pricing problem, right? So these are the 3 things. So you start with a whole bunch of issues, and then you basically start grouping them and say that, hey, I cannot give the interviewer more than 3 factors, but I have 10. So let me group them and give them. Make sense? Any questions so far?
Pavan? I just had a question. I wanted to understand from you whether the approach that I was thinking was in terms of grouping makes sense. So in terms of revenue decline, it could either also be because of the increase in expense or decrease in sales. So if you group them into these 2 buckets and then go bottom in the hierarchy.
Yeah. You can do that. Hey, increase in expense or decrease in revenues is profitability.
Yes.
But we were only talking about revenue.
The sales, in the decrease in the sales.
Okay, fair enough. Decrease in the sales, or what's the other metric that you talked about?
These 2 metrics. So dividing them into 2 buckets, either there's an increase in the expenses or decrease in
So the question that we talked about was only about decrease in revenues. So we did So we did. So the bucket about increase in expenses is not necessary at all.
Okay.
This is a very, very, very common problem that I've noticed. Glad that you brought up that a lot of folks, if you ask them to do a profitability case, they will do a revenue case. And if you ask them to do a revenue case, they'll bring costs into the mix. Right. So one of the good things that you need to do as a consultant or like an aspirant or a solving the case interviews, the first thing that you need to do is repeat the problem statement and basically play it back to the interviewer and tell them that, hey, this is what is the case interview question. Did I get it right versus not? Okay. Just for fun, let me give you guys a actual case. This what I've given you is a sample case. Right. Let me give you an actual case question. Okay. Imagine the case questions are never displayed. So you need to write down notes. Okay. Okay. So here is the case question. Our client is B Health, a healthcare company in the US. It insures both patients and provides healthcare services. Employers pay a fixed premium to B Health for each of their employees, in return for which BeHealth covers all the necessary health services of the employees, ranging from physician care, medications to hospitalization. Right? BeHealth currently has 300,000 patients enrolled in its plan, and it has 300 salaried physicians. These physicians represent a wide range of specialty areas, but not all. When a patient needs medication and that's not covered by BeHealth physician, they are referred outside of the network for care. And BeHealth pays all referral costs on a fee-for-service basis. BeHealth doesn't own any hospitals itself. Instead, they contract services from several locations. Now, what has happened in the last 6 months? BeHealth CEO has noticed that their revenues are falling down and even profitability. How can you improve BeHealth's financial situation? This is the average length of a case. Just so that you don't get a wrong expectation that a case should be 2 lines.
Could you please repeat the starting bit of it? I think a couple of us did miss it while writing.
Okay. Yeah. Our client is BeHealth, a healthcare company based out of the US. It insures patients and also provides healthcare services. Employers. Primarily, BeHealth is a B2B company, and employers pay a fixed premium to BeHealth for each of their employees, in return for which BeHealth covers all necessary health services of the employee, ranging from physician care, medication to hospitalization.
Sir, can you just repeat the data part, sir?
No, sorry. I don't want to repeat the data part again. That's basically killing.
Sir, can I repeat the question just to confirm that?
Just hold on for a second. Let everybody digest the question. Okay. I still see a few heads down. So let's make sure that everybody is up. Okay, guys, now, Surya has raised his hand. Surya, go ahead.
Sir, since you have given a problem where revenue and profitability both are decreasing, right? I'm confirming from you.
Yes, correct.
So we have to first make a matrix since profitability is declining. So we already know that there is a problem in revenue and...
Not right now. Let's go to somebody else. Anybody else wants to be?
Actually, I was not finished, so it's okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
Hi, Sadeepshika, this side.
Okay, go ahead.
So I'll just like to re-clarify the question and restate it. So this is the BeHealth company that is based in US and it provides healthcare and insurance. The major revenue source is from the B2B side of the business that comes from the employers who pay the money for their employees for the health insurance. The facilities, there are 300,000 patients and there are 300 physicians who are employed currently. And if any of these circumstances occur that is not covered within BeHealth, they refer the patients outside.
Correct.
And also the hospitals are not under BeHealth, so it is contracted. So it's a third party hospital facility that they are utilizing.
Correct.
From where I see that revenue and profit has been a decline. So I assume that it is the only problem concern of BeHealth, revenue and the decline in the profits. So is there something else that we should be concerned about?
Okay, good. So this is what, how you basically rephrase the question. So this is exactly the first thing that I want to hear, right? So you rephrase the entire question so that, hey, you basically mentioned to the interviewer, actually what Deepshika, sorry, I'm not able to get your right name right, but what you mentioned is that, hey, is you did 99% of the things, right? You can always improve. Let me give you one tip on how to improve even further, right? So the first thing, guys, everybody need to make sure that, hey, this is how you synthesize the information and play it back to the interviewer, even before you get into the metrics, right, Surya? You should not get into the answer right away. No point, because the interviewer is not interested in knowing the answer. The interviewer is interested in evaluating you.
Yes.
That's the difference, right? So once you repeat, you can always ask, hey, you captured all the information brilliantly, no questions about that. But in case if you miss it, right, you can always say towards the end that, hey, this is the problem statement. Is there anything else, right, that we need to solve for? Also, did I miss any information? If you add that last sentence, right, you are basically putting the moral obligation on the interviewer to help you out. Right? Hey, if you miss, I am a very bad interviewer, but if somebody says this, I have an obligation to help them out. Right? I need to tell them that, hey, you missed this number or you got this number wrong. Right? So you basically engage that other person in the conversation. Right? Then what happens? Now this is the first step. Okay. Now what is the next step? You play it back, confirm the specific question, you confirm the question prompt. Next what? Remember, guys, this is not about the answer, right? And the interviewer is interested in evaluating you, not the answer. Go ahead, Surya.
So the next step would be, should I look into the revenue side or the expense side since the profitability is going low?
No.
And
you are jumping two steps ahead.
Hi, sir, Utkarsh.
We'll ask some basic questions.
Okay. Clarifying questions.
If you have any questions. Right, guys, remember, this is not difficult, but this is the process. You need to stick to the process. Only if you stick to the process, you will reduce the errors. Right, Ashish, go ahead.
Yes, sir. So we'll be asking the questions like, is this the same scenario going on with all the insurance providers, or is it just our company?
Okay.
That means we'll be evaluating the...
I get it. Okay, then what next?
So if there's no change in the external factors, we'll then move on to the internal thing. And we'll talk to them about the change in the clients.
Hey, no. Ashish, you are mixing questions with answers.
Okay.
No. You basically complete your questions, get some information from them, and then you say that, hey, then you go to what Surya is saying, that, hey, I want to create a matrix or I want to create a structure. That's how you go. But anybody wants to take a shot at what are the questions, you can answer.
Sir, I can ask the client, you know, why does the company do like hire the contract, this thing? Okay.
Okay.
Why they are going on contract basis, and what was the revenues for the last years? Okay. What was the trend of decrease in revenues? And I can ask, you know, is there any social problems that has been happened in this recent years?
Okay,
that has you know, made the revenues of the patients to go down, so they are not choosing this insurance.
Okay.
All right. So
then you only have three questions. Anybody yes. else has any other questions?
We can ask them, like,
go ahead, Shweta.
Okay, we can ask them, like, if any pandemic breakout happened there, so maybe because of that more patients are looking to hospital.
Okay,
something.
All right, so okay,
I have one question, sir.
Go ahead.
Does the insurance company have changed any process or the quality of the doctors treating changed in this
particular? Got it. Okay.
Yeah.
So I have one more question,
sir. Sorry, hold on, guys. So 1 second. Okay. Now, if you guys literally want to ask questions, you can ask 100 questions, right? Then again, you don't want the conversation to become into a Q&A session, right? You just want to have a conversation. You literally ask questions if you believe that question will change the answer. Okay, so broad questions, right? For example, I think it was Jagan or somebody was asking the first question that, hey, how do they run business? Or did they change something fundamentally in the last 1 year, right? Or ask those broad-based questions right at the start. Don't go into the very specifics like, hey, was there a social impact or was there a social impact? Was there anything specific? Because what happens is you get to know about the specifics. But again, remember, if we go back to our whiteboard, right? If there are 10 factors, you need to, before jumping into the basic details about each factors, you need to talk about the 10 high level factors right at the start, right? And then combine into various buckets, right? These 10 factors. And that's how you proceed. So asking detailed questions will not change the answer first. So don't go into the details questions. So start with a very broad level question that, hey, did they change anything fundamentally in the last 1 year? Right? Or, hey, is there any difference in the way in which they are doing their business? Right? Or is this been a long-standing problem? Whatever, right? But just keep it at a very high level. Then you move into the structuring part. Okay? Now, Surya, let's go to you. And what is your answer? Sorry for keeping you waiting, but what's the answer?
I will go to, definitely what Jagan said, we have to clarify the questions like what is the revenue, how revenue has been coming to the business. Second, since revenue is declining and profitability is declining, so we have to drill down to two matrices. One is cost and one is the revenue.
Okay.
Yeah. In revenue, we have to look into two categories. I have to ask you whether should I look into revenue since revenue is declining, or should I take cost first?
Hey, you just mentioned only two factors. High level, right? You don't need 2 minutes to think about these factors. So yes. You need to expand the answer a bit more. Tell me a few more factors.
So in revenues, do I have to look about the number of patients, those who are coming to your health services, either they are declining or we have reduced the prices that a patient has to pay to help to avail the health services.
Okay.
These are the two parts for the cost. For the cost, there could be two kind of cost which we generally drill into. One is fixed and second is the variable cost.
Okay.
Can I bifurcate cost also?
Okay, yeah.
Okay, so in fixed cost, in fixed cost, there are different kind of bifurcations we can make. Location of the healthcare facility, which we are, location of any healthcare facility, which is either, is it increased or different equipments or different cost which goes into establishing of that
that. If we take a second, okay. Now let's change the question completely. Okay, instead of a healthcare provider, let's put the same guys in terms of a airlines companies. Revenues have declined. Imagine this is pre-COVID era, and you are in 2019. That hey, revenues for an airlines company are going down. Or rather the profitability is going down, what could be the reasons and how could you improve it, right? The factors that you mentioned, Surya, are exactly the same, right? A revenues, I look at the number of tickets sold and the price per ticket, and costs, I will look at fixed and variable.
Yes.
So I'm not saying it's a bad answer. Of course, it's a decent answer, but it is not a good answer as well, right? Because hey, you remove any kind of client and put any client and keep the problem statement same, the factors will remain the same.
Yes.
So you need to think about now, hey, you've heard probably a 500 word case statement, right? So now you need to pull in the details from the client case statement that you have heard and start applying in the structure.
Yes.
Can you improve the structure? So
yes.
Can you think about some factors based on the stuff that you have heard? Anybody?
So I would like to first understand from the client maybe which sector has been affected. Is it the insurance sector or is it the hospitalization part which has been affected?
Insurance.
Okay. So.
Yeah. So guys, you have got a...
Hi Pawan, this is Vivid this side.
Yeah.
Yeah. So as you mentioned that the profitability of the situation has gone down. And you have also mentioned that the revenue has gone down. And since we can split that, we can say that the profitability equals to revenue minus cost. And since the cost is constant, so we would like to drill down upon the revenue part. So now you told that the company has got 300,000 of subscriptions with it. And since the number is constant, so I would like to know about the premium of the employer. So how much the premium each person pays? So that would be my first question. My second question would be, has the number of external reimbursement for the external claims increased in the past time? So if this is the situation that I would like to also know.
Okay, awesome. So just give me 1 second. You made a classic mistake. Let me tell you what's that mistake so that nobody does that mistake ever again. Okay. You immediately said that, hey, what did I say? I said that there is an issue with profitability. That's where I left. Right? Did I say you the costs are fixed? Did I tell you that the costs are fixed? No.
No.
You assume with that, hey, the costs are fixed. So please don't assume things and cut down pieces of the answer. My entire answer sheet talks only about cost. But hey, don't worry about revenues. The costs are increasing. And now if you say that to me, I'll be like, okay, how do I help this guy? Right? With all the right intentions, I want to help the candidate. But if the candidate is immediately assuming something, so this is called a hypothesis-driven approach. What you did is that, hey, I hypothesize that, hey, this guy should do A, right? The question is, let's say if Reliance should enter into Sri Lanka, your hypothesis could be that, hey, yes, they should enter. Okay, that's what you are doing. Hey, I'm assuming that the problem is with the cost or the revenue and taking out the cost. So don't go in with a hypothesis. Don't go in with a preconceived notion that the problem could be in one area. You don't know where the problem is. Keep all your options open.
Pawan?
Yeah, go ahead.
Actually, I have an approach for this particular problem.
Okay.
You know, I would like to have this 3C approach. One is the from the side of company, where it could
which approach?
3C's approach, companies, competitors, and customers.
Okay.
So, where, you know, company would have a different product or service.
Yeah, Jagan, 1 second, right? So, I think I'm adding too many complexities into the mix, which I shouldn't be doing. But Jagan, even if you are using a specific approach, please don't say that.
Yes, I know that.
Because, hey, why would McKinsey or like why would this company pay a McKinsey consultant $1 million to bring up a 3C approach from a textbook? They themselves
buy a textbook. Yes.
So don't bring up the name of the and rather, hey, let me tell you the answer, guys, right? I mean, hey, we are talking about exactly the points that Surya has mentioned, right? Hey, revenues, ABC, costs, fixed and variables. We had a lot of commentary about referral costs, right? Hey, the referral costs or that hey, these guys are probably using doctors from the third party network if some specialty is not within their in-house, right? Then bring up those points that, hey, are the referral costs increasing? The referral costs could go into the variable cost, right? The in-house doctors, they mentioned that there are 300 salaried physicians, right? Did you basically, are you utilizing all these guys, right? Are these guys going on referring everybody outside network, right? What's the risk profile of the employees that you are insuring, right? So you don't need to use any approach, guys, honestly. Approach will only help you get started. Your answer will be in the question itself. Okay. If for a generic question, now think about a generic question like, hey, it's not always a one page, 500 line or a 500 word question. A question could be as simple as, hey, what should Reliance do? Should it enter into Sri Lanka or no? What do you do? Right. Hey, now everybody's answer could be the same. Right. You think about 10 different things, you group them. And you say that, hey, Reliance should look at these factors. They should look at competitors, they should look at pricing, they should look at customers, 3Cs framework, like what Jagan is saying, everybody would do the same thing, right? Now, if you know a bit more about telecom, that would help a lot. If you know a bit more about what's happening in the 5G space, what's happening in the lower priced telecom markets, right? That can help you differentiate the answer. And since all of you have certain years of experience, it is expected from you that you at least know the basics of industry. Even if you are not coming from that industry, people do expect that you know a few things, right? So good place for you to go and get these insights. Please go to McKinsey, BCG, Bain websites. And these guys have written articles. And imagine, where are these guys writing these articles from? Based on their experiences with the clients, right? And where are the interview questions coming from? Based on their experiences from the clients. So the same information is coming into two different sources. So you basically need to get information from one source and apply it at the other.
Oh, hi, Pawan. I had a question. Yeah. So regarding the case, you mentioned about the other cases are being referred. So is it not a point of concern that whether more number of cases are going to reference or not?
Yeah, that's a discussion. That's probably the reason why the profitability is going down.
And if it is going there, then we may have to change these 300,000 of people according to the new requirement or new
cases. Do you want to change your customers or do you want to change your employees?
Physicians, sorry, 300 physicians that we are mentioning. So shall we not be concerned on that of like upskilling or changing the skill set that we have?
Archita, I don't want to discuss the specifics of the case. You are completely right. You can go in whichever direction you want. My only recommendation would be go into the direction based on the information already provided in the case. So fair enough. Okay. You can do that. Guys,
about the plans that these companies offering, like there'll be a premium.
No. So I don't have that information with me. So I rather don't want to go into that. Okay.
Sir, Utkarsh, can I just take a question, please? Hello.
So this video is stopped. Just give it a minute, please.
Hey guys.
Hi, sir.
I can hear you.
Sir, I have a question. Can I please take it up, please, right now?
Utkarsh, 1 second. His audio is still on mute.
Hey guys, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Hey, sorry about that. Sorry about that. So guys, I don't know where I lost you, but it was basically conversation with Archita. But I want to basically use the next 5 to 6 minutes to just recap what we have learned so far, right? Because there were a lot of things that we talked about. So rather better summarize what we have learned so that at least you have some key takeaways from the session. Okay. Can somebody start sharing very, very quickly what you have absorbed?
Sir, the first step of solving any case study should be rephrasing the question. It's about reiterating the question and asking if there is any other objectives.
Okay. Yeah. What next?
Hello, sir. Varun Desai. So first we discussed about the basics of the three different question types that you discussed, and the focus on the third type.
Second type. Then, that's fine.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Second type. After the rephrasing the question part, then we'll be again, the next step will be grouping.
Okay. Before grouping, it is basically
ask the question on a
broader question. Asking clarifying questions.
Go ahead. Then what next after grouping?
Structure.
In the start, sir, instead of going deep, you should go broad.
Thank you for mentioning that.
An important point to never assume things.
Sorry?
Not to assume things.
Not to assume not things.
Assuming things.
No hypothesis-driven answers.
Do not reveal the approach.
I wouldn't say do not reveal the approach. You should not rather use a generic framework, right? Okay. Because when you put in so many of the client factors, the approach will become very specific. You can't say that I'm using a generic approach, but you're right. Even if you have no option and you are using an approach, don't say the name. Okay.
Have some idea about industry.
I would refer MBB Insights here. Okay. What else?
So a tree structure, like casing, grouping in the tree structure format.
Okay.
A limit to 3 points in the tree. Three main points.
Okay. What else? You guys have covered quite a bit. Really appreciate that.
Read articles from McKinsey and BCG so that we can apply this information.
Asking the questions, it should not be like a question and answer session. Only if the question makes impact to your answer, right, then ask that. Yeah.
One more point would be use the data from the case which has been provided.
Exactly. Okay, so
the answer lies in the question.
Again, sorry, yeah.
Again,
you basically start from there. It's not like literally the answer in the question, but you start from there. But hey, yes, just to give you with key three takeaways from the session, the first bucket is about the question types, right? That's what we discussed about. That in case studies in academic world is different from the actual business world versus the interviews. You know the differences very well. The basics of case solving, rephrasing the question, asking the question, creating a tree structure and limiting to 3 points, right? These are the basics. You do it, whether you like it or not, you do it in every case that you solve. Okay, now how do you get better? You get better by getting that appropriate industry knowledge. Using the case, right? No hypothesis-driven answers. Prefer breadth over the depth. Okay? I would rather take this and put it here itself. Okay? These are the three buckets into which I will summarize the takeaways from this session.
I'm sorry to interrupt, Pavan.
Yeah,
so we have covered quite a bit for like the pointers for case solving, but I feel there's a major component missing, and that's the recommendation part.
So. Yeah. So you're right. We did not get to that point. Unfortunately, you basically start thinking about, hey, once you put in a structure, then you get into the recommendations. You're right. It's that we just did not get to that point yet. But I don't know who's that, who mentioned that one. Let me.
Priyanka.
So Priyanka, typically, this is what I would say, okay? You lose the interviewer, or you rather lose the interview in the first 5 minutes, okay? If the first 5 minutes you don't do well, it's very hard to make sure that you change the perception of the interviewer. And literally what we talked about is about the first 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Doesn't mean the rest of the part is not important, but that hey, 80% of the discussion or 80% of the evaluation is happening in the first time. It's very easy to understand that hey, whether somebody is good with communication, whether somebody is able to structure their thoughts, all of that in the first 5 minutes itself. You don't even need half an hour.
Okay.
All you are doing is you're just having a confirmation bias later.
Okay,
makes sense.
Yes.
One question here.
Yeah. So any questions, guys, from any of you? I hope this was helpful.
Sir, am I audible?
Swaroop this side.
So what would be some good sources to practice these questions from? Like, I just wanted to go online and, you know, see some questions like this so that I can try my hands at this.
I was waiting somebody would ask this question. Of course, which one would be the best source, right? I co-founded a company called Cases Over Coffee. Right? So that would be the best source is what I would say, but no, kidding. You basically, the case that I gave you guys, the Be Health was from the case that we wrote this week. So you can check out Case Over Coffee, or Victor Chang is probably one of the most well-known case interview seekers. Victor Chang resources are very, very, very well renowned. Okay. Both there is a long series and there is a Case Interview Secrets. Case Interview Secrets is a much shorter book. It's a 200 page book. But there are a few other books which are like probably 700 pages. I don't know. You don't even have that kind of time for sure. So you can probably in your groups, you can divide 20 pages each and do that stuff. Case Interview Secrets and Longs, Look Over My Shoulder is a very expensive resource. So don't even want to go there. If any of you is actually interested in solving cases, I have written a post. I don't know if any of you follow me on LinkedIn. I've written a post on LinkedIn a couple of days back. Please follow me. And you will notice a post which has resources to almost 35 to 40 cases which are available out there. And these are two cases are from McKinsey website, two cases from Bain website, two cases from BCG, six or seven cases from Accenture. So I put all of these things on one specific post itself, the links to all of them. You can just go there and practice these cases. And one thing which I would recommend first, before you wasting others' time, right, by showing off your case solving skills, first practice at least 5 to 10 cases by yourself. And then go ahead and start practicing with your partner. Otherwise, you're wasting your time and their time. Don't do that.
Hi, sir. Utkarsh here. Can I take the question, please? Sir, I had two questions. First of all, in the start of the session, you said that for the creative people, you know, this consulting job might not be the perfect fit. Like, you know, I didn't get the word right, but you said for creativity, it might be because, you know, you get the ideas out of the box. So can you just give me a little insight about that? Like, how exactly is that the case? And if consulting is not the, you know, the arena for them, then what's the best arena for them?
I don't know about other industries, to be very honest. I'm not the right person to speak about other industries, but I can speak about consulting, and all I can say that every single recommendation, every single insight that you provide to a client has to have some kind of rationale or backup, right? And a lot of times when you are dealing with creative people, you don't just have that rationale, right? It's a different skill altogether. So both of these don't work so much in terms of this, hey, fast-paced, like, hey, rational-based decision-making. You have to move 10 steps in one single day. And if somebody asks you why you took that sixth and seventh steps, you still need to show them the reason, right? So I don't know if which other professions will help you skip that reason part, to be very honest. Especially for an MBA guys, right? Again, for an arts guy, it's a pretty easy answer to give. But for an MBA guy, I don't know which answer. What's the answer?
So if I take this, you know, as a compliment, I guess if somebody has a creative mind and also has a rational mind and can amalgamate that, I guess then that person can basically, you know, can survive on this side, correct?
I think so. I think I got what you said. And yes, is the answer based on what I understood.
Okay. Sir, I have another question on this part. The last case, actually, I was not able to speak in the meantime. Sir, regarding this, you know, just taking the question, step next to what Deepshika said about summarizing and rephrasing the question and then asking for the doubts or details. You said about asking about the broad details. So if in case, you know, I just ask the, you know, the interviewer, okay, can you just give me the details, like how exactly were the sales, how exactly were the, you can say, revenue and everything in 2018, 19 and 20, and how exactly has been the changes in the policies, some sort of clients or franchisees or training. So if I get all the broad details in the first place itself, rather than, you know, just thinking my mind.
Hey, Utkarsh, don't ask all those things. The first question that you need to ask is, hey, interviewer, do you have any data? If the answer is no, all your questions are basically not relevant.
Sounds good, sir. Definitely. Thank you very much.
So you need to basically keep thinking about that one answer or that one step beyond what you are already asking, right? Hey, simple question, right? Hey, do you have any data? If the answer is no, you know all the questions are irrelevant. But I would highly, highly encourage you guys to go ahead, solve cases, because there's no, this is not a difficult skill, but this is only a time-taking skill. And the good thing is that, hey, you prepare for cases, you ask 90% of the top MBA schools around the world, everybody will say that, hey, I want to be a consultant. I believe the reason is actually they don't want to be a consultant, but rather they're interested in this entire preparation process, right? Because as you learn about case solving, it helps you become better at acing other interviews as well, right? So get that comfort with case solving. Please go there, check out those 30, 40 cases. You will recognize that, hey, some of them are difficult, some of them are easy, but fundamentally, all of them are interesting. You guys have chosen to get into MBA program to basically solve some interesting problems. So cases are definitely the right starting point.
Hi, sir. I had a question for you. So basically, you moved to entrepreneurship. So like being in such a successful firm, still you moved to entrepreneurship. So my question was, what is it between entrepreneurship versus consultancy? Like, what do you felt about
the shift? I think that's an, I can talk about it for an hour and we'll lose everybody either to sleep or to, they'll just drop off to do probably better things in life. But no, I don't have such, I basically moved for personal reasons. After consulting, people, you typically work with different industries, different clients. So hey, you don't want to go and do the same thing again, right? Hey, if as a consultant, I work with, or rather I interacted with a lot of CEOs, but if I go to any corporate, I probably won't get, if I go and join Pepsi today, I'll probably be given the role of an associate director for Asia, for marketing. But I would never get a chance to work with the CEO directly, or it would take at least 10 years, right? So if I think about, hey, what do I want to do? Probably I want to build something rather than working with people probably two or three levels below who I was working with previously. That was some simple thought
process. A part of suggestion for many of us might want to go for entrepreneurship at the later stage of our life. So what shall we be grasping from this, like if we get the role of a consultancy?
Good question. Make good friendships. Get those one or two people who can be your co-founders, because that's my biggest takeaway. I had a co-founder from INSEAD. And if you ask me, the entire INSEAD fees is just worth that, right? Because I don't think you will get that comfort level with any other group other than your classmates here, right? Who are professionally accomplished. That work has been done by XLRI. They already took care of filtering out a lot of people. They already are giving you a good base of people to work with. And entrepreneurship, mostly, at least I believe for the first 2 years, is anyways a struggle for anybody. And all you need is like good friends to basically be a part of that journey. And I think you will find that people only in your school. Or if you have not found so far, this is a very good place for them to continue that. Everything else, thinking or, hey, what should be my strategy course? What should be my statistics, null hypothesis, all that stuff, you will anyways forget.
Thank you.
Hi, Pawan. So this is Anuj.
Yeah, go ahead, Anuj.
Just one question. So you, I mean, I have heard this before as well, that never reveal our frameworks. I just wanted to know how serious is this mistake? I mean, can we still handle it somehow or?
No, very serious.
Sorry?
Very serious. That's it. Okay. I mean, there's no discussion to it. If you are basically revealing the framework, you are out of the interview there itself.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Sir, I have a question. Firstly, yeah. Sir, how to get used to different kind of industry? You told to practice different cases.
Go to McKinsey BCG.
Read into MBB insights. Still, sometimes it happens in the middle of the, you know, solving case that we start getting panicked. Ki whether we are going into right direction or we are taking the case interview all into wrong direction, because we are the ones who are driving the case. So for example, if I pick up something like...
So yeah, if you solve, let's say 50 cases, right? Most probably you would find these reasons in the case that you will solve next. Okay. You solve 1,000 cases. Do you think the 1,001 case would be radically different from what you have solved previously?
No.
No, right? Not I mean, radically. There are only so many business problems in the world that all the leaders are solving, right? So as you practice more and more, you get used to the factors in these industries,
okay.
Right? And if you are combining them with your insights from the MBB websites, these are the latest thinking or latest factors, right? So a combination should be good. I would say, even if you want to just get your hang around it, like just solve cases from MBB websites, then go and solve cases on Accenture, then go solve case on Dahlberg and FSG websites, because Dahlberg FSG is a social consulting firm, right? So their case studies are different versus MBBs are corporate consulting firms. Their case studies are different versus Accenture is more into supply chain. Their case studies are a little different. So as you solve those 30 to 40 cases that I'm talking about, you'll get a very good mix of different factors.
Okay, thank you, sir. That is one problem. As soon as the industry is out of my comfort zone, I start panicking. Like, I'm not able to make the bifurcations properly.
Basically, they start using some kind of a parallel industries, adjacent industries, which you can learn from, right? Hey, if you are talking about healthcare, right? Hey, there is a supply, there is an issue with a, there are long lead lines at the counters in the hospitals. How can we reduce these counters at the emergency services, right? What do? You probably say that, hey, I go ahead and look at F1 racing. F1 racing, the biggest challenge is that at any given pit stop, the car shouldn't stop for more than 4 seconds. So how did they solve this emergency problem? So you pick from whatever you know. If you don't know that, pick something else. But you need to proceed forward.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
There is no guarantee you will know everything, right? So you need to keep picking from whatever you know.
Thank you so much, sir. This was truly an interactive and enriching session. I would like to now hand over to Mehak for the word of thanks.
So with this, we have come to the end of a fantastic session. I'm sure that each one of us would agree that this session has been one of the most enriching and interactive ones so far. Sir, your insights on case problem and problem solving have been very interesting, as it has always been one of the most integral parts of consulting interviews worldwide. It not only helps to enhance the analytical and logical mindset, but also widens our thought process and approach towards a business problem. So it has been an absolute honor to host you this evening. Once again, I would like to thank you for sparing your time on a Monday evening and meeting us and being so patient throughout the question and answers. Thank you so much, sir. This really means a lot to us.
Hey, thank you, guys. Thank you. This was the most formal vote of thanks ever that I have received so far. The most formal. So thanks, Mahek, for that. I'll remember this for a very long time. I will hope to engage in more and more conversations with you, either on LinkedIn or any other platform. So tomorrow I have an interesting conversation with an undergrad student, but just see, you don't know what you can learn from these guys, right? So having an Instagram conversation, I'm looking forward to hearing from all of you at least an year from now, saying that, hey, Pawan, thank you so much. That session was helpful. And by the way, I cracked this one because of your session. That would be the real vote of thanks. So anyways, thank you so much, guys. Truly enjoyed the session and look forward to keeping in touch with all of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Take care. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. Bye.
Are?